Upstate Medical University in Syracuse, New York invites you to be the informed patient with the podcast that features experts from Central New York's only academic medical center. I'm your host, Amber Smith. People who are diagnosed with bipolar disorder after the age of 50 have what is known as late-onset bipolar disorder, and its treatment presents some unique challenges. Here to discuss this complex diagnosis is Dr. Luba Leontieva. She's an associate professor in the Department of Psychiatry at Upstate and the director of the Inpatient Psychiatric Unit for Upstate University Hospital. Welcome back to The Informed Patient, Dr. Leontieva.
Thank you, Amber. Thank you for having me.
Well, let's start with a description of bipolar disorder.
Sure. So the bipolar disorder, which used to be named manic depressive disorder, is a mood disorder. So people have problems with their mood. To be qualified for bipolar disorder, a person needs to have an episodic mood changes, which is different from their baseline functioning. For example, there was a distinction between types of bipolar. So for bipolar one, the patient or the person has to have a manic episode and may not have depressive episode. For a bipolar two disorder, the patient should have a hypomanic episode and depressive episodes. And there is a different type of unspecified bipolar disorder when we cannot really say with great assurance what kind of episodes somebody has.
So the manic is the high part and the depression is the low part.
Correct.
And you said it's episodic. So is it, does it change with the seasons or does it change more quickly than that?
So the rule of thumb kind of to understand the bipolar disorder, because there is a lot of diagnosis in psychiatry that overlapped with bipolar condition, is that for the true bipolar disorder, someone has to have a distinct period of different mood, which is very different from the baseline functioning. And then the person should have a period of functioning well and having no mood changes, no mood episodes.
I see. Now, how common is bipolar disorder, or how many people does it affect?
So overall, the bipolar disorder is about 4.4% in population. There is a good study done that, across multiple countries that says that it's 2.4%, from which about 0.6% is bipolar one, where people have manic episode. And then about 0.4% is bipolar 2, where people don't ever have manic episodes, but may have depressed and hypomanic episodes.
And do we know what percent are in people over age 50? I know we'll be getting into this a lot more, but just number-wise, what percent are
about
over age 50?
Think about quarter of those.
I see. And is it more common in females or males?
Equally common, no gender differences.
What age is it usually diagnosed?
Usually it's a young people condition. So usually bipolar is diagnosed in their 20s.
Okay. Do we know what caused bipolar disorder?
It's genetic predisposition. There is no distinct cause of bipolar condition.
So if you have family members who had it, you may have a higher chance of having it yourself?
Correct. Right.
What are the typical symptoms, or how would a person start to know they need help?
So usually that depends if the person experienced manic or depressed episode. But usually, let's talk about the elevated mood, the manic or hypomanic episode. So the person would start requiring less sleep. And this is very different from unable to sleep. It's just people don't need sleep. They feel energetic and they have lots of projects in their mind.
And if it's depressive, maybe there would be more sleep?
Either more sleep, or sleep is superficial, or, a person will not be able to have rest after sleeping, and also depressed mood, sadness, self-depreciation, feeling of guilt, suicidal thoughts.
Now, are there medical conditions that a person might have at the same time they've got bipolar disorder?
Medical conditions that mimic bipolar disorder is taking prednisone or steroid medication. And in some people with predisposition to bipolar disorder, having a steroids administered to them can trigger the manic or hypomanic episode.
How is it usually diagnosed?
Diagnosed by psychiatrists usually, but because we have less psychiatrists than primary care doctors can diagnose bipolar disorder. And they certainly can distinguish the manic or depressive condition from somebody's baseline.
And then they would likely refer them to a psychiatrist.
Yes, that's an ideal.
Now, are the symptoms the same in someone over age 50?
So the symptoms may be the same, but what happens in older adults is that there is a condition which we call neurocognitive disorders, or common name dementias, that can, the progression of them can, and the start of them can overlap with bipolar condition.
This is Upstate's The Informed Patient podcast. I'm your host, Amber Smith. I'm talking with psychiatrist Luba Leontieva. She's the director of the inpatient psychiatric unit at Upstate University Hospital, and we're talking about late-onset bipolar disorder. So for those people with late-onset bipolar disorder, has the disorder developed later in life, or have they just gone undiagnosed or untreated for years?
When we diagnose late-onset bipolar disorder is when the condition bipolar disorder developed late in life.
Do we know what causes that to happen?
Again, it's a genetic predisposition, most likely, but also neurocognitive disorder that can develop possibly late in life, as well as stress and taking drugs or certain medications. Being on certain medications, if somebody is on predisposition with bipolar disorder, can trigger the episodes.
Okay. Now, what might treatment consist of?
Usually, we treat bipolar condition with mood stabilizers, which are medications like lithium, lamotrigine, proic acid. Nowadays, there is a second generation antipsychotic medications that have also mood stabilizing component in them, such as Abilify or aripiprazole, or olanzapine or zyprexin.
Now, would these be medications a person would need to take indefinitely, or are they medications that can cure the condition?
Usually, individuals with bipolar disorder can take medication until the psychiatrist has thorough evaluation and determined that the medications are no longer needed.
What are the risks of bipolar disorder going untreated?
Oh, the risk can be very detrimental. Breakage of a long-term marital relationship, legal problems, all sorts of things. Losing jobs.
Now, you and your co-authors wrote about a patient for the medical journal Curious who was diagnosed in his 60s. Can you tell us a little about that case?
So we had a gentleman who was diagnosed by his primary care doctor in his late 60s. And he came to us after he was out of control at home with threats to the relatives and no sleep, various multiple projects, very irritable. So the family was at the wit's end with the gentleman. So good news that he came to get help. And in his case, he had a condition that came to life in his 60s, was treated with mood stabilizer and second generation antipsychotic medication by the primary care. The dosages, unfortunately, were not up to recommended dosage. And with additional stressors and the episode coming to life, he became very ill and required inpatient psychiatric admission.
Let's talk a little about what is unique about bipolar disorder that is late onset.
So the unique characteristic, we always have to rule out dementias. And a special type of dementia, it's frontal temporal dementia, which manifests sometimes in this manic-like behavior. People start to be very sexually disinhibited. They sleep less. They have lots of projects. They spend money unwisely. And with that, there is a certain brain scans, the CT of the head and the MRI of the brain that needs to be done, and certain consultation with neurologists and lab work needs to be done to rule it out.
Does bipolar disease, does that increase somebody's risk for dementia later in life?
Not directly.
Are there other concerns, given that older people may have other medical conditions in addition to bipolar disorder? Does that affect the way you're able to treat them?
Yes, because as we all get older, we eliminate at a slower rate. And the medications, they all eliminate extraneous substances in our body. So we have to be very careful about the dosages of the mood stabilizers and antipsychotic medications if need be, and to treat with a lower dose.
Now, we've talked about medication. Is psychotherapy ever part of the treatment?
Psychotherapy is very important, and the goal of psychotherapy is usually to recognize the triggers for the episode. So the person is educated and the family is educated. When somebody who has bipolar episodes in their past started to needed less sleep, becoming more talkative, having lots of projects that they cannot finish, then this is a red flag. And it's better to get help before the full episode emerges.
What advice do you have for loved ones or spouses or adult children about how to help someone with bipolar disorder?
The main advice is to be vigilant about the episodes and also to have it treated as any other conditions. So not to blame or shame the person for having that, but, you know, to be supportive and to be helpful in helping the person recognize that maybe this is a harbingers of him or her having the episode, the manic or hypomanic episode, and the help is needed. And the family is there to help, not to blame the person or put him or her away.
Interesting. Well, thank you so much for taking time to tell us about this, Dr. Leontieva.
Thank you for having me.
My guest has been Dr. Luba Leontieva. She's an associate professor in the Department of Psychiatry at Upstate and the director of the Inpatient Psychiatric Unit for Upstate University Hospital. The Informed Patient is the podcast covering health, science, and medicine, brought to you by Upstate Medical University in Syracuse, New York, and produced by Jim Howe, with sound engineering by Bill Broquel and graphic design by Dan Cameron. Find our archive of previous episodes at upstate.edu/informed. If you enjoyed this episode, please invite a friend to listen. You can also rate and review the Informed Patient podcast on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, YouTube, or wherever you tune in. This is your host, Amber Smith, thanking you for listening.